Good. So you already read out the title. So the point is here really that by keeping some of the key concepts in MPI separated, we can actually clean up the standard, to say it that way. We can reduce the number of interfaces. So that is sort of the key idea. And I'll explain what I mean by this, or what we mean by this. So this is joint work with Sascha Hunold, also from TU Wien, and Guillaume Mercier, and Dan Holmes. And Dan, I guess you will hear in the next talk. So let's see. So there are really two observations that we made here that drives this. So if you look at these two interfaces here, the MPI neighbor all to all W and the MPI all to all W. And you see here what's really the difference. So there's none if you look at the signature. So both the neighborhood collectives and the standard collectives have the same interface signatures. So this is weird, and maybe we can use that. So what's going on here? So this is our first observation. The second observation has to do with the Cartesian collective communication and Cartesian communicators. So here we have two communication patterns, so one and two. So the left one, so this is supposed to mean kind of extensive computation. The processes communicate in a fixed small neighborhood. So here apparently two dimensions, and this process has four neighbors. And the one on the right has eight neighbors. So what's the difference here? And the difference is that the first one is supported by MPI, by this MPI card create interface, which creates a new communicator with certain properties. And by supported, I here mean two things. So first, Cartesian create gives the opportunity for the MPI library to reorder the processes, so to better exploit the hardware or whatever, or other things. And it also means that the neighborhood collectives can immediately be employed on such a Cartesian communicator. And for the second one on the right, this is not so clear. So this is not supported directly, although it is sort of the same kind of pattern. It just has more neighbors, but it's the same thing. All the processes have a fixed small neighborhood. So how, in order to do this kind of communication, so do reordering with this communication pattern or do collectives, we have to go by hand via the disk graph create interfaces. So this is a discrepancy, which is maybe not so nice. So these are our two basic or our two observations in this paper here. So what do we propose? What do we discuss here? So this is about concepts and fundamentals. So our claim is that by leveraging the in quotation marks of orthogonality of the MPI concepts, so it sounds big, we can actually unify intra communicators, intercommunicators, and neighborhood communicators with respect to collective operations. And we can unify Cartesian and neighborhood collective communication. And unify means getting rid of some interfaces, which is a nice thing. So the MPI standard is already a very big thing. MPI 4.0 will be even bigger, as we heard yesterday. So if there is an opportunity to get rid of interfaces, and actually making the standard clearer and not getting sacrificing any functionality, that might be a good thing. So the claims here, the outcome, and so this is sort of a discussion paper, so maybe it will be taken up by the MPI forum, or you can discuss these things. So this is what we find out in this paper. So first, we can get rid of all special interface functions for the neighborhood collective communication. So all in all, this is about 15 interfaces. So there are the regular ones, the non-blocking ones, and the persistent ones. So 15 interfaces. So that means a lot of pages also in the standard. By doing this, we actually provide new room for introducing new sparse collective operations at no interface burden. Maybe there's no use for these, but maybe there could be a use case, and this is something that we could think about, and there will be no new interfaces needed for doing this. And what we also claim is that we can provide more powerful implementation support for Cartesian communication, so what I said, reordering and collective communication, and maybe for the future some new things to think about, which is currently not so obvious in the standard. And all this comes at a very small cost. So we propose one new interface function, which I will explain, but even that is not really needed. The functionality which is in MPI currently, with that you can implement this function, but it might be good to have this function in the standard. Okay, so the first point, unifying collective communication, so neighborhood and normal collective communication. So in current MPI, there seems to be two schools of thought with respect to collective communication and interfaces. So the one is that we have separate interfaces for different kinds of collective communication. So the sparse neighborhood things have their own interface function. So the neighborhood all to all and et cetera. And the sort of fully connected flat collectives have their own other names. So this is one school of thought, giving a new name to new patterns. And the other school of thought is what is being used for the intercommunicators. Here we have the same interface, so MPI all to all, and if you use that on an intercommunicator, it has a certain meaning, and if you use it on an intercommunicator, it has a different meaning. So the interface has meaning according to what to the type of communicator. So these are two different things, and our observation here is that it might be a good thing to settle for just one of these schools of thought, and we suggest school number two. Okay, so for the next MPI, MPI 4.1, whatever, our idea or our suggestion is that the communication topology alone, so the topology is what is in the communicator alone, determines the semantics of the collective interfaces. So what do we have already in MPI? So this term topology is not really there in the standard, but these things are there. So there's a fully connected topology. That means that all the processes are sort of in a flat, fully connected graph. Everybody can communicate with everybody else and with no cost assumption or whatever, any process can communicate, and collective operations include all the processes. The other topology which is already there is the intercommunicator. So this is kind of a bipartite graph. So we have two domains, and when we communicate, it's always like this, that a process or some processes in one domain communicate with one process or some processes in the other domain. And communication within one domain is not possible with this type of communicator. Yeah? And in particular, the collective communication operations are between domains. So you look in the standard, these are a bit weird, and I guess some people are using this, and so this is useful. And then the third thing, new thing that we suggest here is that a third type of topology is the topology of a directed sparse graph. So that means processes have directed neighborhoods, and processes, so here we impose a new restriction, processes can communicate only with their adjacent processes or with their neighbors in this graph. And the meaning of the collective communication is that they are over neighborhoods, as explained for the neighborhood collectives. So that means there's now only one interface, and the meaning of the interface functions is given by the topology which is sitting inside the communicator. So an MPI all to all applied to a standard communicator, so intercommunicator, is what we all know and love, the all-to-all exchange between all processes in the communicator. And there are these rules that the data are stored in buffers, and the rank order of the processes determine how data are accessed in the buffers. Then there is the all-to-all on the intercommunicator, which some of us know and probably nobody loves. On an intercommunicator, all processes in one domain communicate, exchange messages with all processes in the other domain, and vice versa. Point-to-point communication is only between processes in the two domains, so never within the same domain. Yeah, this is not possible with this type of communicator. And here's a new thing. So all-to-all applied to a communicator which has the topology of a directed graph. That is what is now in the neighborhood collective. So the neighborhood semantics, and here the restriction point-to-point communication is only allowed between Adjacent processing. So communication, point-to-point communication between non-adjacent processes is disallowed, and the MPI implementation could actually check this. And the data are accessed in buffers, which are in the order of the neighbors in the directed graph. This is a bit weird, but this is the way it is. Yeah. And this is determined at the time of this distributed. Sorry, the directed graph communicator is created. Okay, so here we need some advice to users. If you have a distributed graph communicator and if you need to communicate between non-adjacent processes, you must use a different communicator that allows this, for instance, an intra-communicator. And also, if you want to or need to use collective communication across all the processes, again, you would have to use a fully connected communicator, an intra communicator, which allows this. So that means we need this kind of functionality from either an inter communicator or a directed graph communicator to pick out what we call here the base communicator. A better name might be good. This is what we came up with, which is a fully connected inter communicator or all the processes that are not connected in the communicator that we give in here. So this is what users need to dig out, this base communicator, and then they can do a normal collective communication where this is needed, or point-to-point communication between non-adjacent processes if that is needed. Okay, and then we of course have to discuss what should be the semantic of this one. Is this a blocking function or synchronizing or whatever? There are probably different possibilities. This function can be implemented with what's already in MPI, so you can use the getting the group item and use group out and then use a com create, for instance, over the group, and you would have this effect. Also, we suggest to deprecate the com test inter function, which tests if something is an intercommunicator, and instead introduce a new topology type, namely MPI inter, for checking this kind of thing. So again, we can save one interface. And in the future, this opens room for now new discussions. So what about multipartite topologies, where we have several domains? It might be possible to give some interesting and useful meaning to collective operations and on such things. And what about non-disjoint multipartite domains? Maybe even that could be given some meaning, collective meaning, and you have the interfaces, and the meaning is determined by this kind of communicator and whatever things that you might be able to come up with. Also, this immediately opens up for more collectives on directed graphs or distributed graphs. So, for instance, an MPI bcast on a directed graph, that could mean that we do a broadcast only in the neighborhood of the root and all the other processes don't do anything. Maybe that is useful. Maybe not. I think that this particular thing could be useful, and we could think about such things, and it could be introduced without any new interface functions. All reduce could mean a reduction in all the neighborhoods concurrently. This would have meaning if you insist that the reduction operation is a commutative operator, and whatever. And a lot of the other ones could also be given a similar meaning. Okay, so this was the first part, unifying collective communication. And semantics is determined by what is in the topology information that is in the communicator. So that is the point here. Our second point or second observation is on Cartesian communication. So in current MPI, we can create Cartesian communicators. This is a very weird and very special kind of object. And the thing here is that a Cartesian communicator actually does two things. So it specifies both a naming scheme. So processes are placed in a grid, a d-dimensional grid, and have a name there, which is their coordinates. And at the same time, it also introduces implicitly a communication pattern. Yeah. And what is the communication pattern? The pattern is that each process is supposed to be a neighbor to the processes along the grid dimensions. and nothing else. So these are the two things that a Cartesian communicator does. And our suggestion is to separate these two things, because doing it this way has certain drawbacks. So what are some of the drawbacks? So this is often, has often been said, here are some papers that I know well, but it is also said in other papers by other people. So the current the Cartesian communicators, so this way of creating neighborhoods is inflexible, and it is inconsistent with what you can do with a distributed graph creation function. So for instance, the connections to the neighbors have no weights. Also, and I think this is a particular drawback, the order of the neighborhoods is fixed. So there's this implicit order, how your neighbors are given. And I'm sure everybody forgets this. You have to look in the standard. Maybe you may make mistakes. It would be better if you could control this order so that it fits your application. And this is not possible. That you have to do via a distributed graph communicator. Yeah. And then the third point is that the reordering is with respect to this implicit neighborhood only. So you can only do reordering with respect to as we saw in the my example, the 5-point stencil. If you have the 9-point stencil or the 27-point stencil in 3-dimension or something completely weird, some other kind of stencil, the MPI card create is oblivious to that, and it cannot reorder in order for this particular communication pattern. All this would have to be done by hand via the distributed graph interface. So our suggestion here in this paper is to give less power actually to the MPI card create and actually call this something else. Okay, so this is for the next MPI, MPI 4.1, maybe, or something else. To say that Cartesianness is only and purely a naming scheme. So the topological aspects of these communicators, they are only captured by distributed graph communicators or directed graphs. So we suggest that card create, or here we call it card name, all only fixes this naming scheme, so that you organize, you tell MPI, okay, my processes are organized in a grid of D dimensions, and there's a name, there's a translation between ranks and positions in this grid. So this is what we mean by a naming scheme. We could give additional parameters here, so maybe say whether the ordering should be row major, column major, or something else or whatever. There are many more things that you could think of here that could make a lot of sense in this naming scheme. Yeah, and then the naming scheme goes into the communicator. So here the suggestion is that no new communicator is created. There's just this naming information is somehow attached to the communicator. Maybe this is good. Maybe you actually would like that a new communicator is created. That is for discussion. But here we of course need to insist that this kind of operation is collective, so that all processes call with the same naming scheme. Otherwise, things go, of course, completely wrong. An important thing here is also that here is no reordering. Okay, a naming scheme means that we need that there is a way to translate between the names and the ranks. So here, coordinates and ranks. And that's actually all that we need. All the rest that you would like could be written as convenience functions in some additional library. This does not have to be in the MPI standard, is what we think. Only this is what is needed in a naming scheme. Okay. So also Cartesianness is no longer a topological property of a communicator. So this topo test, which says MPI card, that needs to go out, but maybe there could be some other query function on a naming scheme. What do I? Okay. So here, let me give some examples how we could use this. So here is our 9-point stencil. So that means each process has 8 neighbors, and we specify the neighbors by relative offsets for the process. And then it would be nice to for a process to be able to navigate in this space with the offsets. So you give an offset, and then you find out what is the rank of the process at that offset relative to me. And the other way around, we could have a generalized shift function. So you give an offset, and then for this offset, so you could say the lower left, upper right is my offset. and then you get the source rank and the destination rank of the processes at this offset. And very useful for doing the collective communication would be to have neighborhood creation functions. So you give a list of offsets, these are my neighbors, and then this function computes a list of source ranks and a list of destination ranks, exactly in the format that is needed for the disk graph create adjacent function. So this would be nice, and everybody can write that for himself in an additional library. It does not have to be in the standard. So here's my example. We use this 9-point stencil, so that means 8 neighbors, and they are written here in this flattened list of the offsets. And we have 8 neighbors, and then I use this library function neighborhood, the S neighbors, and get out my list of sources and destinations. Yeah, and important here is that I can determine the order. So I can give the order of these neighbors exactly as the applications needed, as the buffers are stored, or what is a good buffer order for my application. This is something which is not possible at all with the current MPI card create thing. Okay, and then we put this thing into MPI disk graph create adjacent function, and here we could use weights and all these things that we might like. For instance, the corner neighbors have less weight, whatever, and these things can be taken into account by the MPI implementation when it tries to do the reordering. So here, with our proposal, there's only one place where reordering is actually done. Okay, here's some other helpful functions, maybe for creating stencils patterns out of the box. And yeah, so in application specific libraries, you could write these kind of things. Okay, in current MPI, so here the claim is if you have to do it all by hand, you have two places where you can do reordering, either in card create. This is wrong because you don't have sufficient information on your stencil neighborhood here. So you might not be able to do the best possible reordering. And if you do it in the disk graph create, you might lose information. Okay, and it's actually possible to do better if you have more information in the stencil, about the stencil, as is shown in some of the papers that I listen at least here. Okay, I think that I'm doing a little bit bad on time, so let's see. So here, also an observation is if you have stencil patterns, so these regular communication patterns where all processes have the same relative neighborhoods, then you can sometimes do something. So this is in this paper here on Cartesian collective communication, you can do message combining, things like that. And the point is that the function which does the creation of the distributed communicator needs to know that. So how can it figure out? And the idea is that when we give a communicator, so this one with the naming scheme, so we tell this graph create that we have that everything is on top of a grid neighborhood, then this this graph create adjacent function can use this information to figure out that actually we are doing stencil communication, and then do the appropriate optimization, select the right collectives for this kind of neighborhood. And this is a very good thing. So this kind of information would be very, very difficult to give in the info object, for instance. We give this information that everything is on top of a grid in D dimensions as part of the input communicator here. So this is very important. And this is what goes into a naming scheme. Yeah. Okay. And the point here is that if you don't know this, finding the graph properties that you might want to know about in order to do optimization of your collectives can be very, very hard. So here, finding out if you just have a graph, so a sparse graph, a directed graph, finding out that this is actually stencil-like computation in some d-dimensional grid is very, very hard. But if you know in advance that it is that this graph is defined on top of a grid, it's actually easy. And how can we do it? Here's the algorithm. You can look that for yourself. You just have to check the communicator. You have to do a few broadcasts that all reduces on the neighborhoods, and all the processes can agree. Indeed, we all use the same kind of neighborhood. It fulfills the properties of stencil computation, and then this graph create adjacent thing can select the proper optimized collective for these kind of communication. So the important thing here is really that we give the information as part of the naming scheme to the disk graph creation function. And then, and all this is not possible with the current API interface. Okay, so here's an example how we then use it. So here we have a stencil thing. We do some all-to-all exchange. We again here, then we use without the neighborhood thing, we just use MPI all-to-all BW on our distributed graph. So this is neighborhood collective communication. And then we have maybe a convergence check. And this is across all the processes. So here we do an all reduce, and we have to use the base communicator, which we have picked out in the beginning with this base, getting the base communicator. Okay, so this is essential that we have this function, and also that the base retains the naming scheme in case we want to do also unrestricted point-to-point communication. Okay, and again, this opens for future things. So maybe other weird naming schemes, polar coordinates, exotic geometries, regularly tiled structures, what know I. So a lot of things that maybe for some application would make a lot of sense. And now the things would be there, and one could think about such things. Okay, last remark here is that in the next MPI, suggestion is to deprecate the DIMS create functionality. And the argument for this, or the reason for this, is that it's a hard problem to do a proper factorization, and the best factorization is actually dependent on the algorithm and the application. The best factorization is dependent on the communication pattern, which is not in this function, and the best factorization is actually also very dependent on the hardware topology, as shown in this paper by Niethammer and Rabenseitler, for instance. So we think that this is not something that the API library can really do. This should be done in application-specific libraries, and API should just make it possible to write such libraries. Okay, so this is about it. So there are two suggestions. We can get rid of the neighborhood interfaces, and we can provide stronger support for Cartesian, so stencil-like communication, by actually exploiting the orthogonality of the MPI concept, which is already there. Good. So I hope I was not too long, and this was the talk.
Okay, thank you, Jesper. So yeah, we're right at 9:30 or 9:30 my time. So we have time maybe for one question. If someone has one, either raise your hand or okay, we have one in Slack here from Marc-André. Would your general proposal surpass what is currently proposed by Rolf and Christoph? Maybe you can comment on that.
I think these two things are kind of orthogonal.
Maybe for background, we should explain what is proposed by Rolf.
I'm not familiar with the current state of Rolf's proposal, but I know.
I presume that the high level is it's the cart weighted create functionality, I think is what he's referring to, right, Marc-André? Yes.
Yeah. So I think it adds a lot of interface burden, which is not really needed. So our proposal here is to do everything via the disk graph create things that are already there. So in that sense, I don't think it adds new power, and it creates a very complex interface function. So that is my suggestion. The earlier proposal by Rolf was also to do this factorization, and I think this is a very hard problem and very hard to do right.
Okay.
So this is probably orthogonal, yeah.
I've promoted Rolf to panelist if he wants to comment just quickly before we move on to the next paper. Rolf, you'll have to unmute yourself if you want to comment. I saw you raise your hand. I can also try to unmute. Yeah. I've unmuted you. We can hear you now.
Yeah. What I see with this card create weighted, the idea was that for factorization, and exactly this factorization, you, Jesper, you throw it completely out of your proposal, but this optimized factorization it's better to have application information and hardware information available. The hardware information is typically not the business of the user. It's a business of the MPI library. And it means the business of the user is only to give information to the MPI library. And that's for having additionally to the current MPI DIMS create an additional new routine MPI card create factorization together with reordering to have the possibility for a maximum of. And if the user is doing the factorization with a somehow, then the MPI has no chance to do it better. That's the idea. And that's not only orthogonal to what you propose, it's a little bit contrary, because you say, okay, we that the MPI library is doing a perfect factorization for later on doing the rank reordering in a perfect way.
Okay. So in the interest of time, thank you, Rolf, for the comment there and the background.
May I comment very briefly on this?
Yes.
very brief, okay, sure. Very brief.
So I think insisting on factorization is a very limited thing. So what we show in this cluster paper that is on the slides is that you can do much better than factorization. So this should not be there. And I think in the interface you propose, you are still limited to only this five-point kind of stencil. And that is also maybe not what applications would need. So yes, I suggest to throw this away if you ask like that.
Okay.
But this is a very interesting discussion.
Mm-hmm.